Good evening, everyone. So the very first editorial which we are going to discuss today is from Hindu newspaper. So this editorial over here is again talking about COVID and the effects on various sectors regarding COVID. So again, we are not going to go into different sector. Again, this editorial is also talking about that how just not to focus in the health sector. How should we focus on other sectors as well? Because again, those can also create a lot of problems. That is, if we are just going to focus on the health sector. So basic idea from this editorial is impact of COVID on different sectors. So again, this comes under the GS paper 3, growth and development. A question can be formed, a mains question regarding this, that is a flattening the COVID-19 curve or dealing with its impact. Choosing sides between these two is not exactly a wise decision. So therefore, a balance must be maintained. That means maintaining a balance is the need of an hour. So why in news again, COVID outbreak has having a negative impact on the various different sectors of our country. So first one over here, if we talk about the economic sector, so we have seen that there is a huge downtrod. India's growth in the fourth quarter of fiscal year 2020 went down by somewhere around 3.1%. According to the Ministry of Statistics and the Chief Economic Advisor of the Government of India, so he said that again, this drop of 3.1%, the main reason behind this drop is the pandemic. So over here in this map also, we can see, for example, in this first image over here, we can see that how, if we talk about 2020, that is red denotes for 2020, the gap, it was somewhere around -3.2. Currently, that is in 2021, this was seen 3.1. Why? Because again, because of this some release in the lockdown, people started coming out, they started stock buying or they started buying up in the bulk amount. So therefore, this amount grew a bit. Employment status over here is shown again. A share of non-farm and government sectors in GSVA. Again, so over this images are telling that how the COVID is affecting different sectors. So again, if you talk about the pharmaceutical sector under the economy only, so pharmaceutical sectors are also, that is India as a country, depends majoritarily on China regarding the supply of the raw material for the pharmaceutical sector. So for the raw material, there is one particular type of ingredient that is active pharmaceutical ingredient. So this API is bulkily available in China. So therefore, we depend majoritarily on China regarding the import of this ingredient. And because of the pandemic situation going on, the imports are hindered. So India is heavily import dependent upon APIs on China. India's API import stands somewhere around $3.5 billion per year. If we talk about the automobile industry, so we are not discussing in very much detail regarding every industry. Why? Because majority of these things have already been covered up. So this is just a compilation of all what we have covered till yet. Automobile industry. So over here, if we talk about the automobile industry, so regarding the automobile industry, the manufacturing units of the automobile industries are highly affected by the pandemic situation. Why? Because again, they do not have workers. They do not have labor available. They are not able to get the raw material supply because of the lack of transportation, because of the lockdown going on. Production decreased, leading to unemployment of the people. And also, if production has decreased, consumption is also being decreased. So this is just like how the supply and the demand are working in the automobile industry of our economy. If we talk about the stock market, the stock market has also seen a worst crash. So stock market also fell somewhere around 3.5%, again, which has seen the second biggest fall in the Sensex history. So if we talk about the currency also, during the March time period, that is when the financial year comes to an end, at that time period, for appreciation of the currency, that time period is very crucial for the appreciation of the currency. But during the 2020, or even 2021 also, no appreciation in the rupee was seen. A huge example of that was 73.25 is the current dollar rate. That means per dollar cost somewhere around 73.25 Indian rupees. So again, India's Indian currency is depreciating instead of appreciation. Fall in customer demands over here, just like if we focus on the market demand and supply concept, very easy. That is, the demand is very less. Why? Because again, because of the lockdown situation. So people are only buying the necessity items. So they're not spending on the luxury items, etc. And when there is no demand, supply is also going to reduce itself. So because of the demand, decrease in demand, supply is also decreasing, again, putting an effect on the factors of production, that is the land, labor, capital, entrepreneur. So over here, travel industry. So because of the lockdown situation, not just in India, but throughout the globe also, that the tourism industry is highly affected. And we know that India has a big tourism industry, and from that, a lot of revenue is generated. So therefore, travel industry has also seen a lot of losses during the pandemic time period. If we talk about the social impact, so we have discussed a number of times regarding the migrant people and what problems they're facing. If we talk about the white collar people, that is the office or the people who are working in the official sectors. So most of those people have not lost their jobs. How? Because again, these people are sitting at their home, working online in the vicinities of their home. But what about the migrant people or the people who are employed in the unofficial sector? So we have studied that how these migrant people, they have to migrate from the urban to the rural areas because they have lack of technological knowledge. So therefore, they are not currently employed, etc. So they barely have the savings for any more waves, because again, majority of the migrant people's savings have already been spent in the first wave. Apart from the migrant workers, gig workers. So who are the gig workers over here? For example, our delivery boys, the cab drivers, etc. All these people are also highly affected. So if you talk about the unemployment rate among the women, so previously, that is a pre-pandemic time period, the unemployment rate was somewhere around 15%. After the COVID situation, the unemployment rate is being seen increasing every day. So it is somewhere around 18% right now. The United Nations Development Program has found an additional 207 million people are pushed to extreme poverty or will be pushed to extreme poverty line, that is somewhere around 2030. Even though the pandemic comes in under control, but the after pandemic effects will be seen till a very long time. So over here, this is the graph of what is the current unemployment percentage. So it's somewhere around 2017, the unemployment percentage was 3.4%. And if we see about the 2020 or 2021, so the unemployment percent currently, an average unemployment percent is 23.5%, which is increasing at a very high rate. Next over here, if we talk about the education sector, so we know that children or the education sector has also faced high waves of the COVID. Majority of the education previously, that is, this is the culture of education, majority of the education was done offline, that is teacher to student interaction. But because of the COVID pandemic, the education platform has to be forced to shift at online platform. And while doing that, a lot of finance, a lot of government help, etc. was required. We discussed this in the brief in previous editorials. So currently, let's focus on these points. That is, shutdown of all education institutes due to rapid spread of COVID time period impacted the entire education system of the country. Also, it created a digital divide. So what is a digital divide? So digital divide is the division between the technological haves or the technological non-haves. So over here, what is happening? Again, this shift from offline to online platform of education. So that also made the education discrimination. How? Because again, we know that if we talk about the current situation of device availability in our country, so in rural areas, either there is no device availability, no internet penetration, and also in urban areas as well, there are many houses who only have one devices. Because of the presence of only one device, the children are not able to, one of the children or two children have to miss their classes so that the other child can take the class. So again, one of them can only take the classes. So that is creating a nuisance situation for students, for teachers as well. Number of dropouts have also increased in the rural area. Why? Because this increase in dropout number is maximum seen in the girls. Why? Because again, previously, with a lot of efforts, girls were being brought to schools. The parents of these people in the rural area were actually taught the importance of education. But now, as these people are not getting the privilege to go to the school offline, neither do these people have devices with them. So their parents are actually engaging their children into household activities, which is also leading the education drive go down the line. Lack of student-teacher interaction and international student mobility has also been decreased. Because again, if we also know that in India, from a lot of countries, every year we receive international students. And in a similar way, our students go to international universities to study. So again, this mobility is also something which has been hindered because of the pandemic situation. So over here, with the help of this image, we are going to focus on the factors which are affecting the online education in India. So first one is availability of quality education. So again, on every online platform, quality education is not available. Employability quotient. So again, this also becomes very difficult to employ more vacant seats. Or employ more faculty or teachers at the with the help of an online platform, because having a face-to-face session of interview, etc., is way more viable. Government digital. Can you please mute your?
Yeah. Proceed.
Thank you, sir. Government's digital initiatives. Again, what does this factor over here say? This factor over here says that how much government is providing to the states so that they can actually provide with the sufficient amount of infrastructure to the schools so that they can conduct the studies online. Because again, education comes under the state list, so it becomes the responsibility of state. Whereas state needs finances or financial help to shift this whole paradigm on the e-platform. So the state government needs the finance, and that could only be provided to them by the central government. Smartphone user base. So again, we know that not all people have smartphones with them. Internet penetration is not in the rural areas. Again, not every person has enough disposable income that they can buy certain new devices, or they can purchase heavy internet packages. Young population. So we know that children over here, young population, sometimes what happens is these children get way more distracted in the online classes. So again, distraction becomes a key element in the lack of education, quality education being provided to the children, and also cost of online education. So these are certain factors. With the help of this graph, we can also see that the dropouts of the education system has been increasing at a very higher percentage. That is, as we are moving more towards the pandemic situation, the more dropouts in the education system can be seen. What are the impact of COVID on the agriculture sector? On the agriculture, the first one is crop production and availability of seed. Because of the lockdown, crop production was less. Because of the less crop production, availability of seeds were also less. And also fertilizer shortage, that is due to global trade disturbance. Certain facilities like fertilizers, pesticides, etc., they were not provided to the farmers in sufficient amount for the agriculture practice. Again, food production and distribution was also harnessed due to lockdown condition. That is, most countries have taken the measures, for example, of home confinement, the travel bans, business closures. That is, these are all the activities which we are seeing currently in our country as well, in order to control the rate of infection. So if we are going to practice all these activities, somehow or anyhow, the distribution, traveling, etc., all these things will be affected. Perishable crops. We know that the nature of crops is perishable. They do not have a very long shelf life. So because of the less time period of shelf life, these crops go perish, or these crops go worse very easily. Lack of stock available on livestock. Okay, so what is the effect of COVID pandemic or the pandemic seen on the livestock? That is, because of the less availability of workers or labor because of the lockdown condition, maintaining of livestock is also becoming very difficult. For example, practice of fisheries also seen very less. So in India, COVID-19 has caused a higher impact on livestock farming due to less access to animal feed and also shortage of labor. if we talk about the workers, the workers with regard to agriculture sector. So these workers do not have a proper health services. They do not have social protection, etc. And even if they follow the social protection, because of them falling in the low to the middle income families, if they are going to follow social protection, they are going to follow the home confinement, they won't be able to do the production. Impact on food demand and food security. The demand for food has also affected due to reduction in income and purchasing capacity. So again, stockpiling foods is also becoming a huge issue. Distribution and supply in supply chain. Again, over here, this is also talking about the distribution, that is taking the material from one place to another place. That is also becoming a huge problem. Impacts on the tribal area. So yesterday, sir mentioned that what are the effects of a pandemic on tribals, that also need to brought in light. So regarding the tribal people, they'll have lost livelihood and shelter. So for example, the tribal people who are stuck into the cities, these people do not have any means to support them, because again, they do not have shelter. They do not have their jobs. Because of the lack of jobs, they do not have money, and therefore leading to no food and no water situation for them. Lack of health infrastructure. Again, health infrastructure is also not available in the tribal region. For example, poor testing system, lack of hospital availability, lack of medicine availability, etc. All the medicine or the health facilities which are not available to these people. Digital device. Again, like yesterday, Ashok sir was also talking regarding this. So he put a lot of emphasis on this, that the tribal people are facing a huge digital device regarding the COVID platform and also regarding everything. So currently we are talking about the COVID platform, because that is the platform through which these people can get themselves vaccinated. And because of the lack of internet penetration in the tribal, in the rural region, this is also creating a huge hindrance for these people. Again, closure of artisans, workplaces, and units of textile workers. So this is also creating a lot of problem for these people. Reverse migration. So what is reverse migration? Migration means moving from the rural areas to the urban areas in search of good jobs. But because of the pandemic situation, urban area, lack of jobs availability to these people, lack of money with these people, so they're coming back home. So that means reverse migration. So because of the reverse migration, that is lack of availability of jobs in the urban areas, so that is also creating a huge impact on the tribal people. Travel restriction, lack of opportunity to earn money, because tribal people, what they used to do, they used to travel from their tribal region to the rural area or some villages or in some towns. They sell their products, for example, their craft product, their artisan's product, they sell over there. So from that they earn, they have their monetary basis from that, from the travel sector. So because of the restrictions in the travel, monetary earnings also see a huge hindrance regarding the regarding the tribal people. Again, these tribal people are very vulnerable. They do not have a good educational background. They are not technologically updated. So therefore, these people are pushed behind in a digital push. So if you talk about the way forward regarding all these factors, one second. Yeah, okay. So yes, Priyanka, due to black market also, black marketing is also a huge effect which can be seen in the economic side for these people. Swayam Prabha platform will have 12 more channels. So currently this Swayam Prabha platform has somewhere around 2 to 3 channels. So what government is doing, government is going to involve themselves with the Swayam Prabha platform. And they're also going to introduce 12 more educational channels. So through which the people who do not have access to internet, they can get certain educational knowledge from here. The government has tied up with the DTH operators to air educational videos. Kisan Sabha apps. So these Kisan Sabha apps are connecting farmers to the supply chain and also regarding the transportation facilities. Kisan Rath app also facilitate the farmers and the traders in search of transporting vehicle for movement. Increasing the allocation of direct benefit transfer to the farmers through the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Yojana, and also including every person under the undertaking during this lockdown. So that means giving more DBT to these people who are suffering the most. Significant role of vaccine can also play a huge role. So therefore, Ministry of Tribal Affairs over here can also be seen working with the Ministry of Finance for the textile and skill development in the tribal region. So over here, the talks are also happening to include NGOs, self-help groups, big institutes like IITs, IIMs, and other stakeholders. So over here, we can also include the private entities. So all these people can form up a group and also focus regarding the vocal for local policy, which will bring the, which will actually help the tribal people. A prelims-based question regarding this, regarding the ENAM. So again, ENAM is a pan-India electronic trading portal which seeks the network to existing physical regulated wholesale market through a virtual platform to create a unified national market for agriculture commodities. Again, ENAM has been proved very benefited because again, it is e-trading platform for the agriculture, for the farmers. So over here, first statement is true. This online trading platform aims at reducing the transaction cost, bridging information asymmetry, and help in expanding the market access to farmers. So this statement is also correct. So third statement says that ENAM platform do not allow the interstate trading of agriculture. So that this over here statement is false, because again, ENAM provides the interstate trade of agriculture. So therefore, statement three is wrong, that which accounts to only statement one and two being correct. Next editorial over here is talking about the surge seen in the foreign direct investment. So what is foreign direct investment? What are the types of foreign direct investment? What is the role of foreign direct investment in the Indian economy? So we are going to study this editorial with this light. So what is FDI? Foreign direct investment is an investment made by a particular company or an individual of one country. For example, country A, in the business interest or in the country of or in the business sector of country B. So over here, a person living in one country or a company in one country is investing in another country in their businesses. So that is called FDI. So if we start go in detail regarding FDI, generally FDI is when a foreign entity acquires the ownership. So that means they're buying something or controlling the stake of shares. So either they are going to take the majority number of share, that is the 51%, or they are going to buy the company in the another country. So over here, foreign word should be noted. That means the person who is buying it does not belong to the home country, the place where they are buying it, or establishes a business there. So that is counted under the foreign direct investment. Foreign direct investment is very different from the foreign portfolio investment, where the foreign entity merely buy the shares of the country or shares of the company. So what is foreign portfolio investment? So in foreign portfolio investment, only shares are being bought, whereas in foreign direct investment, ownership is being brought. In FDI, the foreign entity has a say in their day-to-day operation of the company. Why? Because again, ownership has been bought. FDI is not just the inflow of money, but also inflow of technology, knowledge, skills, and expertise. For example, if a huge company comes into our country, buys or takes the ownership of a company in our country, so they're going to bring their technology, for example, their patented technology, which India does not have yet. They're going to bring that technology. With that technology, they're also going to bring enough knowledge, skills, and expertise also. They're going to employ our people. And after employing of our people, they're going to give training to our people. So again, that will lead to investment of not just the inflow of money, but also inflow of technology, knowledge, skills, and expertise. So it is a major source of non-debt financial resource for economic development of a country. So what is a debt financial resource? For example, if we take a loan for some person, that is a debt financial resource, because somehow we have to pay that loan back. But FDI is a non-debt financial resource, because again, they are investing over here. So we do not have to pay them anything back. This FDI is determined in the host country on the basis of certain things. That means any company is going to buy or do foreign direct investment in our country on the basis of their policy framework. For example, what kind of policies we have, either those policy are in favor of the company or not, rules with respect to entry and the operation of the, or along with the functioning as well, and also along with the exit. So for example, are they allowed to take easy entry or all, are they allowed to take easy exit as well? Trade standards of the foreign affiliations, international agreements between the home country, that means our country, and the country from which the FDI is coming. trade policy. So again, policy is regarding the trade practices in the home country or the country where they are doing the foreign direct investment. So if we talk about the FDI in India, or if we talk about the status of FDI in India, this FDI has been seen, having or experiencing a huge growth. That is somewhere around 23.9% of the growth in 2020, April to June. And also, if we talk about the previous year's fiscal year, again, financial year. So every financial year starts from April. No, it starts from 1st of May and ends at 31st of April. So if you talk about the 2020, 1st of May to January 2021, that means somewhere around 10 months. So $12 billion of FDI has been seen, which actually accounts for a huge amount within the first 10 months of a financial year. So that means this year we have seen a huge surge in the FDI. Why? Because again, India, after the globalization, that is the LPG policy of 1991, we are making the FDI norms very easy every year. And because of the easing of the FDI norms, we are able to attract a lot of FDI companies. That means a lot of foreign direct investment. And India currently stands, India ranks in the list of top 100 country in ease of doing business. So again, ease of doing business also plays a huge role in attracting the foreign direct investment. So what are the FDI routes in India? That means through which routes we can attract the FDI in our country. So currently we have two routes. First one is an automatic route. Second one is a government route. So what is an automatic route? In an automatic route, the foreign entity, that means the person who is doing the investment in our country, they do not need a government approval. So in order to come, in order to do the investment in our country, they need the approval of the RBI. So they do not need the approval of government, nor do they need the approval of RBI. They can automatically come here. Second one is the government route of FDI. So under the government route, again, they need, because as the name suggests, so when the foreign entity wishes to do any sort of investment, they need the permission of the government or the RBI to do so. According to the new FDI policy, the entity of a country, that means the person who is doing the investment, which shares a land border with India, or where the beneficial owner of an investment into India is situated in, or is a citizen of any country, can invest only under the governmental route. So again, this has been brought after the new FDI policy. What are the benefits of FDI? Just now we studied over here, if we talk about the second benefit we study, that is whenever there is an investment coming from outside, they not only bring money, also they also bring technology, they also bring skills and knowledge. FDI also helps us in economic development. How? Because again, if a company or if a foreign entity is going to invest in our home country, so if they invest in a rural area or in any area where the employment rate is low, so they're going to generate employment. After the generation of employment, the people who are employed in that country, in that company, their livelihood is also going to increase. So therefore, their personal income will also increase, leading to somehow economic development, generate more employment, bring in more competitive business environment in the country. So again, if we talk about the home companies of a country, so these home companies can never create a monopoly in the country until and unless there is an open market. That means if there is FDI coming up, the home companies of the countries will also have a competition in their head. That means they will also fight for providing more quality goods and providing it at an affordable rate. Improves the quality of product and service in the service sector as well. What are the disadvantages of FDI? It can affect the domestic investment and domestic companies adversely. So again, if, for example, if an FDI company comes up with certain skills and technology with the domestic companies do not have, that could lead to suppression of the domestic companies or the suppression of MSMEs. Small companies in the country are not able to withstand MNCs, almost a similar explanation. FDI may also adversely affect the exchange rates of the company, because again, it also leads to the devaluation of money instead of revaluation. Government measures to increase FDI in India. So currently, schemes like Production Linked Initiative, that is PLI scheme in 2020, this has made electronic manufacturing attract FDI. So in electronic manufacturing, we have allowed FDI. In 2019, FDI policy of 2017 was amended by the government, and government actually permitted 100% of FDI under the automatic rule route. That means no prior permission will be asked from the government or the RBI, again directly. That means automatically the foreign entity can come into our country, invest in the coal mining sector. So this accounts for 100% automatic FDI. So that this has been amended in 2019, the FDI policy of 2017. Government permitted 26% of FDI in the digital sector. Foreign Investment Facilitation Portal, that means online single point interface of the Government of India with investors to facilitate FDI. Again, government is actually making the norms more relaxed, more easy to attract the FDI. What are the major government authorities which are linked with FDI? So very famous are the major government authorities linked with the FDI are Foreign Investment Promotion Board, RBI, SEBI, Ministry of Corporate Affairs and Government of India, Tax Department, several other Ministry of Government of India such as the Power Ministry, Information Ministry, Communication Ministry, Energy Ministry, etc. Sorry. So what is the way forward with FDI? That is, FDI is a major driver of economic growth, that just now we studied how, and also an important source of non-debt finance for economic development of a country. Economic growth in the post-pandemic period depends largely on the FDI as well. Why? Because again, in our country, we are facing financial problems. And with the FDI, that means attraction of more foreign direct investment in our country, we'll have more finances and more development going in our country. Question, a prelims-based question, that is statements regarding FDI. So it is when a foreign entity acquires ownership or controlling stake in the share of a company in one country. So again, over here, this statement is true. In the very first slide, we studied this. FDI is the major source of non-debt financial resources for economic development of the country. Again, in the very first slide, we studied this. So over here, both these two statements accounts to be true. The last editorial over here is from Indian Express. So over here, this editorial is talking about treating.
Gurlin.
Yes, sir.
Ashok sir is waiting, and after completion of sir, then you can take up further.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Ashok sir, good evening, sir.
Sir, I'm.
Let her complete the flow because she's been already in the flow.
No issue, sir. Your time is valuable. I know that. Please proceed, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I've given you the host status as well.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Given.
Yeah.
Given, sir.
Ha.
Thank you, sir.
You are host now, sir.
PowerPoint. Good evening. Good evening, dear friends. Today we will discuss four important headlines that are figured in the Hindu, and we try to provide an analysis of the same. So the first one that I'm going to discuss is the BRICS that will help India in fighting COVID-19, says China minister. Now, what is this BRICS about? And then we are going to discuss about that. So the news that has come in the BRICS is the foreign minister of the BRICS, that is Brazil, Russia, India, China, have expressed grave concern with regard to this global pandemic situation of Corona, COVID-19. So they expressed the concern, and they discussed several issues. So let's discuss what is the BRICS and how it is relevant to us, and what you should know about BRICS, and what you should remember about BRICS from the examination point of view. BRICS is an acronym for five emerging economies of the world: Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Please remember, BRICS is an acronym for Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. And the term BRIC was coined by Jim O'Neill, the then chairman of the Goldman Sachs, in 2001. And the first BRIC summit took place in the year 2009 in Yekaterinburg, that is Russia. So the it started its origin in Russia. In 2010, South Africa formally joined the association, making it BRICS. So with the completion, joining of South Africa, it became, instead of BRIC, BRICS, because the word S has come from the alphabet S. So BRICS is an association with more than, what is the importance of the BRICS? It's an association with more than 40% of the global population and with 25% of the global GDP, gross domestic product, nominal GDP of the year, about $16.039 and an estimated about $4 trillion US in combined foreign exchange. So that is the significance, the economic power that it commands, the together coming to, by together and try to have a say in the global forum. Now that is the importance of the BRICS, both underlying the underlying economic power as much as the political geopolitical presence in the geopolitical situation. That is the importance of the BRICS. The bilateral relations are conducted mainly on the basis of equality and mutual benefit. So this is the key. So these five nations come together on the basis of principle of equality and mutual benefit. Okay, that is I benefit you and you benefit me. And it's a mutually benefiting process as much as the equality. So we don't treat, for example, Russia may be ahead of the other countries, China may be ahead of the other countries among the five. But we want to deal here in this forum, we want to deal on equality. So the principle of equality and also on the functioning of, on the principle of mutual benefit. So the BRICS is formed. It's a perfect organization in that sense that it will take care of the mutual needs in one-to-one among the five countries. And also they have a multilateral discussions as much as the principle of equality and mutual benefit. So the foreign minister of the BRICS, now why it is in the news? Foreign minister of the BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa grouping expressed grave concern with regard to the global COVID pandemic problem, as you know. Addressing this virtual meeting, Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi expressed solidarity with India over the recent surge in COVID-19 cases and said the grouping was ready to assist the country to fight the pandemic as long as it is needed. So this is the statement made by Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi. So during the conference, he said that there should be, we should come together in joining forces in order to defeat this grave pandemic that has been affecting us globally. And it has shattered our economy as much as also brought a crisis to the humanity in our countries. So it is important that we come together, express solidarity and fight joint forces to defeat this COVID-19 situation. Ministers also agreed in reforming the multilateral system, which was the first time that such a consensus was reached. So you see, whenever there is a forum and a discussion, China might talk, Russia may not agree. Or Russia may put forward its agenda, but China may not agree. So for the first time, as you can see, Russia and China are opposed to each other most of the time ideologically. And India is almost sandwiched. India, of course, has its own agenda. So setting aside our agenda, we have come together in a consensus for the first time. Now, that is the greatness of this meeting. So ministers also agreed on reforming the multilateral system, which was the first time that such a consensus was reached. So that is the significance. The first time consensus reaching is something very rare and unique, because all the five countries have their importance, their own economic priorities, their own political ideological priorities. And as you can see, India is a democratic country, China is communist, Russia of course is communist, and Brazil, you know, and South Africa. So there are different ideological, political, ideological, and economic scenarios are different, but yet they have come together first time expressing solidarity and reached a consensus first time. That is the significance again. So what did they say? A joint statement issued after the meeting called for equitable access to vaccines, medicines, and technologies, as well as equipment to deal with the pandemic. Now, this is a very, very important scenario. See, the world all over now, we are talking about these intellectual property rights. Those who made the vaccines, they dictate the terms. Those who engage in the research and funding of these, they want to dictate the terms and condition. No, but because but the whole humanity is reeling under the impact of the COVID, and hence it is important that we share the benefits of the science, technology, research, development, and a vaccine for the entire country, for the entire world, population of the entire world. But, so therefore, they said equitable access to vaccines and medicines and technology as well as equipment, because the ventilators, oxygen concentrators, oxygen cylinders, vaccine, most important medicine, earlier like we had remdesivir, and now we are talking about cocktail and the technologies that needed to resuscitate and revive and also treat effectively and take care of the COVID patients across these countries. No, we require some kind of equality, equitable access, so that all these five countries should have a equitable access. So there should not be any differences in terms of their economic condition or their ideology, and they should come together and gain this equal access. Because it appears that the rich countries are trying to dominate the poor, and nobody is talking about the poor. If you look, take a map and start looking at vaccine producing countries and those who are requiring vaccine, you see a great disparity again, a great divide between the rich and the poor. And this is something very difficult for all of us to understand, because it is a crisis scenario, and this is not tolerable and acceptable. While vast humanity is suffering, reeling under the impact, only few people have the technology, and that is in terms of intellectual property right of the vaccines, and they don't want to part with the developing countries and some of the poorest nations like Africa. Nobody is talking about Africa. Nobody is talking about Latin America. And those who already have the research funding and who have gained the access to the vaccine, who seemingly hold. So even the presidents of these nations, rich nations, they are not willing to part with the intellectual property rights. So Mr. reaffirmed that the need to use all relevant measures during the pandemic, including supporting ongoing mechanisms in the World Trade Organization and a COVID-19 vaccine intellectual property rights waiver. So we are demanding, I mean, the ministers who have gathered in this BRICS, they said that there is a need to use all relevant measures during the pandemic, and also support ongoing consideration in the WTO for the waiver of the intellectual property rights. So this is a very, let us discuss what is this intellectual property. I mean, those who have who did the research and funding and who engage in the research, they seem to get the rights, and that the people who want to produce the vaccine need to take this permission. Now, it is very shocking to know that because of this crisis, about 11 to 12 people have become billionaire overnight because of this vaccine production. So the vaccine has made billionaires overnight. Some of these people who are holding this WTO, the intellectual property rights. So this is the anomaly. There is a need for them to tell them to give permission and waive off this requirement of taking permission from the developers of the vaccine in order to save the humanity in time. Because while somebody's crisis is somebody's opportunity should not be looked at. I mean, their opportunity, opportunity to become rich should not be dealt with or should not be viewed against the crisis that is humanity is facing among these countries. So it is not like somebody's one's crisis is one's opportunity. So the intellectual property rights, those who are owning the intellectual property rights seem to have taking an opportunity out of the crisis that these nations are facing. This is not acceptable. The science is for humanity. Technology is for humanity, for the benefit of humanity. When Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin, he never made about intellectual property rights. When so many discoveries were made, Alexander, inventions were made earlier, they were all becoming immediately available to the mankind. Hence, a vast majority of the human population was saved in terms of many science and technology discoveries. It has, in fact, averted many deaths and conquered many diseases. Smallpox is an example. Smallpox vaccination, smallpox disease was affecting pandemically, that is globally, and almost many countries were affected. But because of the vaccine discovery and it was applied till 1979, the total smallpox was eradicated. It was the biggest conquest story in the history of the medicine. So there was no issue about intellectual property rights at that time. When the world is placing pandemic, can you tend to bargain with your intellectual property rights? Is this fair enough for those who have intellectual property rights? That is the issue to be discussed. And that was the point that they were trying to make these ministers. So the foreign minister also expressed, because earlier so many humanity was saved because all the discoveries applied to everybody and there was no such thing as intellectual property waiver, intellectual property right. And as such, because they have a right, there is a need to waive. So this scenario was not there earlier. Hence, we could conquer many diseases and cooperate globally. This is the time to come together globally to save the humanity, not to bargain for intellectual property rights and requesting the waiver of the intellectual property rights. And those who are holding back this permission of the intellectual, to give the permission of the intellectual property rights or waive of this intellectual property so that we can go for mass production and more people can be provided access with the vaccine. This is the vaccine, medicines, equipment, and also many aspects related to the pandemic, handling of the pandemic. So this is the importance of this. They've raised the voice and they also sought for the waiver of the intellectual property rights because it is not correct to ask for the their benefit, economic benefits when the whole humanity is reeling under the impact of that. And there it's a life-threatening situation and they need to be saved. And so there should be a waiver of the intellectual property rights because science and technology has already been used to benefit the mankind, not to divide, and also that rich bargain at the expense of the poor's lives. This is the scenario. The foreign minister also expressed the support for the comprehensive strengthening and reforming of the UN Security Council, the General Council Assembly, the UN Secretariat, and the Economic and Social Council. Sorry. The statement also reflected the grouping's determination to deal with the global terrorism and also the expressed commitment to fully implement the BRICS counter-terrorism strategy. These countries are also facing threats again from the terrorism. So global terrorism seems to be a great menace in addition to this pandemic. And there is a need, this forum is used and the joint declaration statement is also issued reflecting the group's determination to deal with the global terrorism and express commitment to fully implement the BRICS counter-terrorism strategy. So they have we have formed this counter-terrorism strategy. And we said, just as we have to waiver the intellectual property rights, come together, express solidarity, and discuss on the principles of equality and mutual benefit, there is also need to come together to fight the global terrorism and implement the BRICS counter-terrorism strategy. Now, this is the importance of the BRICS. It's a very important meeting, and I'm sure this is going to be very, you know the importance of that now, and a likely question in the examination. So consider the following statement about BRICS. BRICS is an acronym for five developing countries of the world. In 2009, South Africa formally joined the association, making it BRICS. So the correct answer is A. That is, BRICS is an acronym for five developing countries of the world, meaning Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Please remember the membership also, because there can be a question like 1 and 2 or 2 or 4 and so on. So this is the importance of the BRICS. Now we go on to the next one. There was another news that Congress Chief Minister's question exclusion from GOM. So the Chief Ministers of the Congress ruled with Rajasthan and Chhattisgarh have questioned the Union Government decisions not to include finance ministers from the Congress ruled states in the group of ministers formed to examine the issue of GST exemptions to COVID-19 relief material. You know that GST, Goods Sales and Services Tax, which is a one nation, one tax policy. So there is a request from the government, the state governments, that they should be exempted from the relief that they are carrying out from the imposition of this GST tax on those relief measures, and also using various materials in the relief, goods and materials that are used in the relief measures in the COVID situation. Now, the Congress, the Congress ruling states have been excluded in the group of ministers. That is, they have been deprived of their voice, articulate their voice, and they were not given representation in this group of ministers to articulate their grievances. their problems and how it should be done. And there, this is, while it should be mutually inclusive, it has been excluded. So Congress chief minister, that is those states ruled by Congress chief minister, Congress governments, are strategically excluded from the group of ministers. And there, Congress, those chief ministers of the Congress ruled governments in those respective states are questioning why they were left out. And particularly the finance ministers of this Congress ruling states have been left out in the inclusion of the this council and membership, and they were not allowed to participate, and without and so they could cannot put forth their across their views, their grievances, their demands, their problems. If they cannot be heard, you cannot solve redress equally enough. So there should not be any politics in terms of group of, while you constituting a group of minister, it should be all inclusive, not exclusive. This is the controversy about this news. This is the demand made by the Congress chief ministers. So, Congress CMs, sorry, Congress chief ministers question exclusion from GOM. So they are questioning, this is the news. Group of ministers have been constituted from time to time to look into different issues and subjects. What are the group of ministers? They have been constituted from time to time to look into different issue subjects like GST. It could be 15th Commission Finance Share, or it could be the grants in rate 275 article, as you know, grant in aids. There are issues. Sometimes they don't get the allocation properly. Some states, they're deprived. Particularly in the GST context, many states are feeling let down. And they feel that they have not been given adequate share of their revenue while they're carrying out their developmental activities. So from the GST pool. So this is the one important issue why it has been coming in the news. These are the, what are group of ministers? These are ad hoc bodies formed to give recommendations to the cabinet on certain emergent issues and critical problem areas. So emergent issues like pandemic today, or COVID relief operation, or the imposition of the taxes, exemption, need to exempt the, from the taxes while you are carrying out the relief aspects of the COVID. So they were set up. So what are the group of ministers? This is to take decisions on various matters such as corruption, interstate water disputes, administrative reforms. Interstate, how the water should be aided by the riparian states. That is those who are having the coastal area, how they should have the share. How, not only that, while the water is flowing through, while the rivers are flowing through two or three different states, how the water has to be shared, like in Andhra and Telangana, as you know, there are many issues about Godavari, Krishna River, water sharing, lifting of the water, etc., etc. So all this have to be addressed by setting up. So group of ministers take care of that scenario, that kind of problems. Group ministers heading the concerned ministries are inducted into the relevant GOMs. So if it is a water dispute, so what are honorable water related ministers, and then also advice is crystallized, they are there. So it comes for a purpose. Group of ministers is constituted for a given purpose. It could be to prevent corruption, or it could be interwater, or it could be for COVID GST, or it could be for administrative reform. So they hold, and the concerned ministers of that given subject will be inducted into that, and also the other members, and they discuss on that forum, and they also formulate certain decisions, and they implement. As soon as the decisions are implemented, that group of ministers becomes disbanded. They come for, so it is ad hoc body. What is the meaning of ad hoc body? Coming for a purpose together. Suddenly some purpose arises, like COVID. COVID was not anticipated in our constitution or anywhere. And so, but now the scenario has come. So therefore there's a need to cooperate and also take into account the grievances of various group of ministers, state ministers, in trying to arrive at how exemptions have been given, what could be the quantum of exemption, what could be the magnitude of the exemption, and how it has to be done, what could be the fair share of revenue from this particular GST pool. All this has to be addressed. So for a given purpose, they will come together and they implement, take decisions, come together, discuss, hear all the relevant ministers and also members, and then come to a conclusion, consensus, implement, take decisions, implement, and finally, when the implementation is over, that group of ministers created for that purpose is disbanded. Some of these GOMs have been already also empowered to take decisions on behalf of the cabinet, known as empowered groups of ministers. So this is more important, in fact. GOM is for a power, and they are only in a recommendatory nature, and they try to recommend after the meeting. But in the empowered group of ministers, they have the power even to take decisions to implement whatever that they have discussed. So in the group of ministers, it is recommendatory in nature, and in the empowered group of ministers, it is implementary. Even they can, they are empowered to take decisions. So that is the importance of group minister. So group of ministers becomes so important that sometimes, depending on the scenario, situation, emergency, urgency of a situation, they take decisions on behalf of the cabinet. So this is the importance of the group of ministers. So there were 21 GOMs when UPA 1 was in power. There were 9 empowered group of ministers that as well during that period. There were 27 GOMs and 24 EGOMs during UPA second government. So these were the number. But with the time in the constitution of a large number of GOMs has resulted in many GOMs not being able to meet regularly to complete their work, thus leading to significant delays on many major issues. Thus, all the group of ministers and empowered group of ministers were abolished in 2014. Because of the functional difficulty, operational difficulty, for example, the group of ministers may be from different parts of the country, convenience of their time to come together. When a meeting is called for, only half of the people are present. Even the quorum is sometimes not possible because some minister of some such state is held up and some minister of state is having some emergency. Supposing there are floods in his state, there is some emergency in another state, an emergency situation. All this may not come together. Attending a meeting of all this would not be possible. So therefore, because meeting them regularly has become a very difficulty, so by 2014, it was abolished. Further, in 2015, 16 informal groups of ministers were formed to discuss key issues of the country. While they abolished because of these functional difficulties and operational problems, because all the ministers, all the members, all the group of ministers that are their members in that group, for that for created for the purpose, we could not be present at the same time during the meetings, and sometimes even quorum could not be there because of the meeting could not be held or could need to be postponed several times, and not achieving the purpose, defeating the very purpose. Therefore, it was abolished. But in 2015, again, 16 informal group of ministers were formed to discuss key issues of the country. So there are two issues here. While you have to ensure the uniform representation of all the states, regardless of the political ideology, whether Congress ruled governments or non-Congress ruled or BJP ruled government, because this is not a forum for politics. This should be fair share of discussion because it affects the all the states in the country. So there is a need to incorporate all state members. That is the importance of this news. And Congress are exactly questioning why you have not included, why only you have excluded Congress-ruled governments and their fair share, their prevented them from expressing their voice, their concern, their problems, their demands, their articulation of their aspirations have not been given representation because you have tactfully or strategically omitted group of ministers from the or the representation of the Congress-ruled government. This is the criticism against the that has appeared in the news, and that's why we are discussing. So what is the incorrect statement about group of ministers? So answer is B. These are permanent bodies formed to give recommendations to the cabinet on certain emergent issues. So many issues emerge from time to time. Like I said, suddenly there is flood, suddenly there is a pandemic, suddenly there could be earthquake, there could be some other interwater dispute, which requires immediate attention, and there's a need to come together on this to solve this as an ad hoc body to solve this problem. So these are permanent bodies formed to give recommendations to the this. So this is incorrect because they are not permanent bodies, they are ad hoc bodies. Please note that. So the incorrect statement among the three is, the first one is ministers adding the concerned ministers are inducted into the list is correct. There are no GOMs right now, and they are abolished in 2014 is also correct. But all statements, the B is not correct because it is not a permanent body. What is it? It is an ad hoc body formed to give recommendation to the cabinet on certain emergency issues or emerging issues. Thank you. The second, third one now. Third one, another important thing that I thought we'll discuss today is National Council, the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights. National Commission for Protection of Child Rights tracks data on orphans. You know, very very tragic situation, really. It is heart-wrenching situation that 9,346 children have either lost a parent or been abandoned during the pandemic. So this is a very sorry state of affairs. Look at what COVID has brought to us. Not only a great disaster to humanity, the children who are assured of their bright future, children who are the future citizens, children who should be given all the opportunity to develop and grow so that they become future citizens and will also contribute to our growth of the country. Some of them have been deprived because of the big pandemic struck their parents and took away their parents, and so many children have become orphaned, either lost their parent, single parent, or sometimes both the parents, and they have become single parent child or sometimes even the orphans. So there's a tracking scenario. There's a tracking of the kind of software, and it had tracked data on orphans, and many have become orphans. Many children have become orphans because their parents have been taken away by the pandemic. So now, what is this National Council Commission for Protection of Child Rights? We'll know that about that, and then we will discuss what is the issue. What is National Commission for Protection of Child Rights? It is set up in March 2007 under the Commission for Protection of Child Rights 2005. It works under the administrative control of the Ministry of Women and Child Development. So what is a child? See, please remember this important thing. This may come as a question. A lot of you think that teenagers are different, children are different. Okay? But this is not so. What is the definition? Child is defined as a person in the age group of 0 to 18 years. Okay? Again, I'm repeating it. The child under the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights is defined as the person in the age group of 0 to 18 years. And up to 18 years is considered as a child. So such children have become now orphans. So because of the pandemic situation. So the commission mandate is, what does commission do? What is this national commission? Why it was set up in 2007 under the Commission for Protection of Child Rights? That to ensure that all laws, policies, programs, and administrative mechanisms are in consonance with the child rights perspective as enshrined in the Constitution of India and also the UN Conventions on the Rights of the Child. Certain basic human rights have been given to the children that they should be given. And they're also there in our Constitution, our fundamental rights, in our directive principles, as much as the human rights, International Convention of Human Rights, as much as in the Sustainable Development Goal, SDGs also, of the UN. So these need to be there. So this is the body in our country, National Commission on Protection of Child Rights, is a mandate to ensure that all laws, all policies, all programs, all administrative mechanisms should be in place as per the child rights perspective as enshrined in these various bodies like Constitution of India, UN Convention and the Rights of the Child. Sorry. Constitution and all. What is the context here? So Bal Swaraj is an online tracking portal of a National Commission for Protection of Child Rights showing details of nearly 10,000 children in the country in immediate need of care and protection. Now, this is the importance. So the online software tracking system has found out that 10,000 children in the country are in immediate need of care and protection. They include children aged between 0 and 17, that is up to 18. Expect orphaned as abandoned during the either orphan or becoming abandoned. Orphan and taken protection, sometimes nobody is there to take care, that is called abandoned. Okay. So during the COVID pandemic, since March 2020, since the COVID struck globally and particularly in India. In India, we had the cases were starting from March onwards, in huge number. And we started acknowledging that there's a pandemic at the time, from March to 2020 onwards. So since March 2020, the huge number of children have become either orphaned or abandoned. That is not taken care of, not protected. So National Commission for Protection of Child Rights informed the Supreme Court that these children ran a high risk of being pushed into trafficking and flesh trade. So this is the unfortunate thing. Girls can be taken into, can be pushed or exploited. And the girl child's children and girl teenager girls can be, become the objects of flesh trade, can be used exploited by the antisocial element and will be pushed into trafficking and flesh trade. That is prostitution and also sexual abuse. That is the danger if we are not taking care of these children. That is the rightly National Commission for Protection of Child Rights warned that because they have become orphaned, there is no one to protect them. They will be exploited by the antisocial elements and they could be pushed into prostitution and also human trafficking. That is again sexual abuse and using them as enslaving them for sexual purpose as much as the using them as a child labor and many other exploitations. So this is the danger. There, if you, these people are not taken care of, there's a high, they may run a high risk of being pushed into trafficking and flesh trade. Not only boys, girls, but also boys. They can be sexually abused, boys, and also they can be become child labor or they become exploited. And there is so much crimes committed against these children from 0 to 18 years. So there's a need for our society to protect them. And in the wake of this pandemic, leaving them abandoned and orphaned, there's a need to protect them. And every care must be taken by the respective government or government of India. And therefore, there's a need to provide total protection so that they will be pushed from, they will not be pushed into trafficking and flesh trade. They will be prevented from exploitation or sexual abuse. So under the right to under the Right to Education Act, what is RTE Act? Under RTE Act is the Right to Education Act 2009. The National Council, National Commission for Protection of Child Rights can inquire into complaints about violation of the, see, the scope of the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights is that it is exists for protecting the rights of the child, as in the commission name itself indicates. So under the Right to Education Act 2009, the NCPCR can inquire into complaints about violation of the law, summon an individual and demand evidence, and it can seek a magisterial inquiry, file a writ petition in the High Court or Supreme Court, approach the governments concerned, that is state governments, wherever the orphans are there, for protection of the, for prosecution of the offender and protection of the victims. Two things, approaching the government concerned for first protecting the victims and also prosecution of the offenders, particularly those who are antisocial elements who are exploiting or say, resorting to sexual abuse or child labor and other forms of abuse, they should be prosecuted. Those offenders should be prosecuted. So this commission has a scope to approach the government concerned and request them and alert them about the need to prosecute these offenders who are exploiting these orphans or abandoned children. And also they have the scope to recommend interim relief to those affected. And who are there in the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights? The commission has a chairperson and six members, of which at least two should be women. You know, Professor Shanshant Sinha from Andhra Pradesh, now, of course, the Telangana, Hyderabad. Now, she was the chairman and she is well known for her anti-child labor activity. That is, she was trying to abolish the child labor. She worked with the child abolition of the child, dedicated her life for the child abolition of child labor. And she was the the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, Shanta Sinha, a renowned personality, as you know. She belongs to the undivided Andhra Pradesh and very much now in Telangana. And she's also touring the various parts of the country. So she did a wonderful service. So she was the chairperson and six members, of which at least two shall be from women. And all of them are appointed by central government for 3-year term. So she did a wonderful work at that time. And she still called on several forums to discuss about it. The maximum age to serve in commission is 65 years for chairman and 60 years for members. So this is the importance. So chairman can go up to their tenure so that they can work very effectively and contribute to the this abolition of exploitation and also protect, particularly to protect the children from the age group of 0 to 18 years. So this is the national, there is a need for this. Now why we are talking about this, I want to just want you to focus on the background. The background is about PM CARES. So the PM CARES fund is there. So the government is coming out with a proposal and there's a demand that every child should be given 10 lakh rupees and that will be deposited from the amount deposited. Every child should be protected for, provided for his studies, for his livelihood, for his survival, for his food and requirement by the bodies and agencies, so that up to 23 years they can be brought up and after that they can have access to that 10 lakhs also for their future. So this is the proposal, that this has been the policy that has been discussed. So in order to, it is important that National Commission for Protection of Child Rights made a very, very important, significant impact, and the rightly raised concern and voice over the many children who are becoming either orphan or abandoned and need to protect them, otherwise they become exploited in the society and their future will be thwarted because of antisocial elements. And there's a need to give, it's our combined duty, collective responsibility of the respective states and the government of India to protect this innocent, poor, hapless and victims of this pandemic. And they should further not become victims of either sexual exploitation or antisocial activity and or any sexual abuse or any form of physical abuse. Therefore, there's a need for us to go. And the National Commission has rightly done its job and brought out this, raised an alarm. And there's also, because of its scope, has alerted many governments, state governments, and have come. So now in this bit that we want to see, B, 2 and 3. So the, consider the following statement about the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights. So the 2 and 3, what is 2? It works under the administrative control of Minister for Women and Child Development. That is correct. It has a chairperson and members of which at least 2 should be women. This is also correct. So 2 and 3 are correct. So this is the important, and it is important that we should be very firmly resolving to protect them from all forms of exploitation and give them a brilliant, bright future, which they are entitled to, just like any other children of the country. And they're only, their poor tragic circumstances because of COVID taking away their parents. So there is a need for collectively for the state. In fact, there is a concept called state children. Who are state children? State children are those children whose parents do not have parents are suffering from problem. And so the state children are called, orphan children are called state children. Meaning when the children have no parents, state is the parent. So this concept is also very correct in the sense, it is important that the state government should enact policies, programs, and a National Commission for Protection for Child Rights will advise this and this state governments to ensure that that these are the children or persons in your state. Please take care of them. It is your collective responsibility in coordination with the government of India. So that is the importance of it. It acts as a bridge. It acts as a recommendatory body. It acts as an advisory body. It acts as also a scientific study body. And also it has operated the Swaraj, that software tracking, and because of which we could know officially that this is 9,346 children have either lost parent or been abandoned during pandemic. Now in the last topic that for today's discussion is science and technology. There has been a news item that in IIT Ropa in Punjab has developed a first of its kind Internet of Things device. IoT is called Internet of Things device, AmbiTag, that records real-time ambient temperature during the transportation of perishable products, vaccines, and even organs and blood. So you see, how do you think that the commodities are carried out? I would like to just tell you that there's something called cryogenic. What is cryogenics? It's a science dealing with the low temperatures. It is the science that deals with the low temperatures. At low temperatures, many perishable commodities, vaccines, body organs and blood can be stored. Stem cells can be sold. Many important vital organs of the body, as much as the vaccines, as much of the very valuable perishable commodities can be stored under low temperatures and can be preserved for a considerable time. Sorry. So the then the it is a, what is a AmbiTac? It is shaped like a USB device. AmbiTac continuously records the temperature of its immediate surroundings from minus 40 to 40 plus 80 degrees in any time zone for a full 90 days on a single charge. What is an AmbiTac? Developed by IIT, it is shaped like a USB portal device, and AmbiTac continuously records the temperature of its immediate surroundings from minus 40 to 80 degrees in any time zone for all full 90 days on a single charge. So most of the similar devices that are available in the international market record data only for a duration of 30 to 60 days. So this is, I got an advantage of 90 days. So 3 months or more duration, more longevity, more care and more preservation time. It generates an alert when the temperature goes beyond a preset limit. Now this is very important because, for example, vaccines have to be given at a particular temperature. If it is exceeding that, or it is not maintaining that lowest temperature, or breaking the temperature and becoming warmer, or going critically above the temperature, then immediately it gives a warning to correct itself, so that correct the monitoring mechanism and the people who are monitoring. It gives an alarm that please take care of the preset limit of the temperature that you should maintain, that cold temperature that you should maintain to preserve that particular item like vaccine, body organs, blood, or any kind of perishable commodities. So far, such devices are being imported in India in a massive quantity from other countries such as Singapore, Hong Kong, Ireland, and China. So earlier we were importing because of the, thanks to IIT innovation, this AmbiTac has become useful to us. So it is also scoring over the other existing one, because it is, while that is, those earlier exist for 30 to 60 days, now AmbiTac can be used to preserve, monitor temperatures for up to 90 days also on a single charge. So far, such devices have been imported earlier. The device has been developed under Technology Innovation Hub. What is the Technology Innovation Hub? So it comes out with the, what is the Agriculture and Water Technology Development Hub, and it's a startup, Scratch Nest. Name of the startup company, Scratch Nest. So it's a great innovation, a great facility, because how will you preserve the blood and body organs and many important things that you need? There are transplantation of cornea, transplantation of kidney, transplantation of heart, transplantation of vital organs of the bodies, and stem cells. All these need to be preserved in the low temperatures. Low temperature is the cryogenics. Hello. Is the underlying principle. It's the science that is dealing with it. And AmbiTac exactly monitors that temperature, and from minus 40 to 80 degrees in any time zone for full 90 days on a single charge, and also gives an alarm if it goes beyond a preset limit. That is, if the temperatures are failing or faltering, then immediately it will give an alarm to correct it, so that the real temperatures can be brought, preservation can be done, and a purpose can be achieved. So what is its application? This device helps whether that particular item, whatever, that is vaccine, blood or organs, stem cells, or vaccine, any kind of the material, perishable commodity, that is transported from anywhere in the world, is still usable or perished because of temperature variation. Because of the change in temperatures from one country to, European countries have very cold temperatures, and like you said, temperate country, and tropical countries have warm climates. So while traveling from a cold country to a warm country, there could be a variation in temperature. So this device helps you to know whether that particular temperature, supposing you're traveling from Europe to Africa. So Europe is the coldest regions, and the African have the warmest regions. So therefore, supposing a person requiring a heart transplantation, kidney transplantation, organ transplantation in Africa, and a device, donors' organs have to be brought from the Europe. So there's a change in temperature anywhere in the world. And there's a danger that it will perish. Supposing you're carrying the body organ to give life to the, breathe life into a person, or give a transplantation so that the life can be saved, the very purpose can be defeated if that becomes a perishable because of the not maintaining proper temperatures and not giving the proper monitoring. So this information is particularly critical for vaccines, including the COVID-19 vaccines, organs and veterans. So the today you can understand very well, all vaccination is successful and can be effectively achieved only when you maintain proper critical temperature. What is it called? Cold chain. So the key word that you should remember is cold chain. Maintaining cold temperature required for that particular vaccines or organs and blood transportation. And in order to maintain that cold chain and to monitor that cold chain mechanism required at the coldest temperature required for particular vaccines, organs and blood transportation and vaccines in particular today, in the today context, there is a need to have an AMITAG. AMITAG is going to be very effective, very useful and achieving the purpose. Besides perishable items, including vegetables, meat and dairy products, it can also monitor the temperature of animals' semen during transit. Meaning, there is artificial insemination so that the there could be hybrid varieties among the animals so that they can give high yield of milk, high yield of meat. As you know, in animal husbandry activities, we need artificial insemination and that can be inseminated into the animals so that they can go for high yield production of the milk or meat. So this is the reason. So not only organs and blood transportation or vaccine, but also vegetables, meat, dairy, which is so much economically important. So this is the device that is actually used, first of its kind device. It is an Internet of Things device. It's called AMBITAG. So AMBITAG, question can come, what is an AMBITAG? It records real-time ambient temperature during the transportation of these perishable commodities, products, vaccine, and even body, organs and blood, and even vegetables, as it is mentioned. So it is like a USB tag device. It continuously records and monitors, enable us to monitor effectively and serve the purpose of say preserving this very, very precious, life-saving, precious, economically important items. Anyway, so the two words that you require remember is, one is cryogenics, other one is cold chain. Cryogenics is a science that deals with the preservation of the items or objects among the cold temperature. And the other one important thing is cold chain is to maintain appropriate temperature, cold temperatures as is required for the vaccine. For example, Pfizer's require different vaccine, a different range of temperature, while Covaxin, Covishield may require different range of temperature. So this particular temperature can be effectively monitored and preserve the potency of the vaccine. The very purpose of the giving vaccine so that it can give protection and immunity to the person, it depends solely on the ability to maintain the temperature at which it is supposed to be maintained. And if this is lost, that means the cold chain is, this is called cold chain, and the range of temperature that it has to be maintained in order to the potency is retained, immunity is given, the purpose is achieved of the vaccine is called cold chain. If it is to be maintained effectively, AMBITAG is the solution, and AMBITAG is making it possible. And hence, today vaccine programs will be more successful, and all the other also organ transportation and other purposes, preservation of valuable items and objects, perishable commodities, life-saving objects can be maintained. In particular, vaccines can be maintained by AMBITAG. A great innovation by the young scientists, startups. They are very much like you, all young aspirants who come out with the idea, attend to the problems that our country is facing. And you see, by well, it is for 60 days for the existing mechanism, AMBITAG is giving that it can go up to 90 days, monitor effectively and preserve the temperatures. So this is the importance of the AMBITAG. It is an IoT device. So this is the, it's an important device to monitor the temperature. So discuss and explain about the ethics. Okay. Now we discussed all about this. So cryogenics and cold chain is behind this principle of AMBITAG. Thank you. I am finished.
Thank you very much, sir.
I think, should I tell about IMD expects more rain in the monsoon months. Okay. That is about IMD. And there is also Moody's Investor Service that is India's GDP forecast to this. So there are two other important things. IMD expects more rain in the monsoon months of June, September than its April estimate. So it said monsoon rain would be 101% of the long period average. What is the long period average? You should look at it. on April 16, and it said the rain would be 98% of the long period average. So what is the long average of during this long period? What could be the average rainfall during this June to September? That called LPA should be looked at. In the agency's parlance, this still constitutes normal rainfall, which is anywhere from 96 to 104% of the long period average of the rainfall. So LPA is the term designed. What is LPA? Today you have come to know what is LPA. So long period average of the rainfall. That's how we measure the rainfall and predict the rainfall's quantum for the given rainfall season, for given monsoon season. Similarly, the Moody's Investor Service cost cuttings 2021-22, India GDP growth forecast to 9.3% from 13.7% earlier, while noting that longer term risks of the economy would increase if the second COVID-19 wave lasted beyond June and the vaccination rollout remained a challenge. So the GDP is directly affecting the, is influenced or affected by the way we can handle COVID because it has an economic ramification and also particularly vaccine challenge that we are facing. Because a vaccine rollout so that all the children, all the population is covered, all the susceptible, vulnerable, and all the young population is covered, subject to that, we could have a very good GDP. China will be for the first time allow couples to have a childbirth in a further relaxation of family planning. And rules 5 years after a two-child policy largely failed to boost birth rates. So just I'm closing by saying only one last news that has come. China is going to, for the first, you know that China is the most populous country in the world. Second is India. But China said that earlier it said that you should couples to register only for one child norm. Later it said it can go, recently it said it can go for two child. Now it is saying even for third child because the birth rates are declining. So this is also one important news. So couple is allowing, China is allowing the couples to have third child. At one time it restricted only single child policy. I have a one only. Now later it revised saying two child. Now China is so disparate that the younger population is decreasing. Old population is increasing. Birth rates are falling. And therefore it is saying that instead of two child, you go for third child in a further relaxation of the existing policy of the two child norm in order to boost the population and promote the younger population and so that labor force is also increased. Thank you very much.
Namaste, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Vinutna.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening. Please proceed.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Let's today talk about a column, Breaking the Cycle of Child Labor is in India Hands. This column is written by... should I wait?
You please continue, ma'am. Please continue.
Okay. Okay. So this column is written by Dagmar Walter. She is the director of Indian Labour Organization, India Country Office. Okay, let us see what she has to say. The columns, it's about children, schools, pandemic, and the child labour. So these are all like, it's a jigsaw of words. We'll see what it is, what the column talks about. So definitely the pandemic is going to have impact on the child labour and children because of two obvious reasons, that the parents are out of work, one, and children haven't been attending school. So both of them compoundly are going to have effect on this phenomenon of child labour. And we have to understand the fact that pandemic itself is not causing the child labor. The problem is pre-existing. It's just that the pandemic is going to amplify this problem of child labor. How and why, we'll look through in the slides. So we look at one data that world now, when we entered into the third decade of 21st century, we have 152 million children around the world who are, I mean, into child labor, and 73 million of them are under hazardous work. Okay, so we are not going to define child labor right now, because we all know what is child labor, who are considered children in India, and we all know what the definition is. But the question here is, how deep is the problem and what we should do to eliminate it? Okay, so let us see some startling facts and figures, like how understand to gauge how, I mean, how deep the problem is. It says, according to the National Sample Survey Organization report, in this age group of 6 to 13 years, okay, so in this age group, 95% of Indian children, and in the age group of 14 to 17, 79.6% of Indian children are able to attend both formal or informal education institutions. And according to 2011 census of India, in this age group of 5 to 14 years, 10.1 million children are working, okay. In this 10.1 million, 8.1 million children are in rural areas, and these children are also engaged in agricultural labor. And UNESCO has taken 2011 census as base. It says that 38.1 million children are out of school right now. And also, according to the national census of 2011 in India, the total population in India in the age group of 5 to 14 years is about 260 million. And in this 10 million of total child population are laborers, they're working either as main workers or marginal workers. So in all, if you see, 1 in 11 children between the age of 5 to 18 years is in the country are working. Okay, so these numbers are definitely not a good thing. So let us see, we all know the child labor is a societal and an economic problem. So the major reasons I've stated here, what is it that the causing the child labor in India? Why is it still existing? One is the poverty. Second is the illiteracy. These two are the two main reasons behind child labor, and parental ignorance that they are not able to foresee the long-term consequences that their children, immediately they are getting money, but what are the long-term impacts? They are not able to realize that. And the improper implementation of child labor laws, and not imposing right penalties, and non-availability of schools, non-accessibility of schools, and most important thing is unpractical and non-capturing school curriculum. What is this? I'll explain this in detail later on. Okay. So, and child labor being available in cheaper prices is another cause. And there are remote corners in India which are practicing bonded labor today. Right. We keep talking about child labor because we still have some statistics to it. But bonded labor is something which goes underreported and unnoticed. Okay. So let us see this toxic cycle. Okay. This is this toxic cycle of child labor and perpetuating poverty. I hope it is clear, the image is clear, but I'll still read it, okay? See, imagine a family living in poverty. It cannot afford sending their children to school. So what will the children be done? They'll be forced to work. So when the children are forced to work, they're not receiving education. And when they're not getting the right education, and when they grow up without basic skills and education, they will end up doing low-paying jobs. And when they end up doing low-paying jobs, girls marry young and have children. And now they have a number of children to support within income. So what they do, they lose their job to younger employees, and there fewer opportunity for adult employment. So then again, they enter into the cycle of poverty. So poor people getting into the child labor again and again. So I've given this, the image here, the cycle, and the boy shows that where exactly can we break this cycle and how exactly can we cut it. Identifying this is the responsibility of us. Okay, let us see. So the government of India has done so many efforts in breaking this cycle of poverty and child labor. So we'll see some of them. One is, way back in 1974, the National Policy for Children was brought, in which it was clearly declared that children are national asset. They are supreme national asset, and proper care has to be taken to harness their potential. You should not let that ruin, okay? And way back in 1979 only, government of India formed the first committee called called Gurupada Swami Committee. This is to study the issue of child labor. And he clearly mentioned that perpetuating poverty and eliminating child labor, both of them cannot go together. Okay, why? I'll tell in coming slides. And under the recommendations of Gurupada Swami Committee only, we have this Child Labor Protection Prohibition and Regulation Act. It was enacted in 1986. And because of this multiple initiatives taken by the government of India, in this decade of 2001 to 2011, there we saw a decline in the child labor numbers. Why there was a decline in the child labor numbers? One is there was a right combination of policy. The policies were made, and there was also the government also intervened exactly where it was required to intervene. Okay, and see, we have introduced MG Narega. So because of this, what has happened? There will be one guaranteed employment in a rural family. So now children will not be treated as an earning hand, and there's right to education. Now it's fundamental right. You're not investing. Government is providing for your child's education. So send him to school. Right to education has been made a fundamental right. And there's midday meal scheme. And when if your child is sent to school, he's offered nutritious food. So at least now parents are being, we are trying to attract parents to send their children to school. Okay. So because of that, in this decade, we have seen the fall in numbers. And the measures continue, because of this, children are made to school, go to school because families are assured income. And there is a National Child Labor Project launched. So what is this National Child Labor Project? Under this, we are trying to converge the efforts of several governmental schemes. And also India has ratified this International Labor Organizations Convention 138 and 182, both of them dealing with child labor. This shows that how inclined India is to eliminate the child labor. We are in fact expressing solidarity with the world nations that we are together in fighting against the child labor. And we have recently launched, which was in news a year ago, that we have launched Pencil Portal. So what is this Pencil Portal? This is a platform where different organizations, they could come, share information, they can get information, where they can coordinate efforts, like draw strategies at national, state, and local levels in effectively enforcing the policies and come up with new things. And there are several operations that are happening in India, like Operation Smile, Operation Muskan, and there are a lot of rides that are happening in the unorganized sector, in the manufacturing units and other factories. So government of India is doing really well in terms of in its measures of eliminating child labor. So now why are we talking about child labor today is because pandemic, which is around us, is definitely going to have its say in this phenomenon of child labor also. One major threat is that if we don't take affirmative actions, there is a threat that all our efforts of bringing children to school will be backtracked. Okay. So because of the pandemic, there is economic insecurity, there's lack of social protection, and the household income has fallen. And now children in poor households, now they are seen as earning hands, and they'll be seen as contributing to the family income. After decadal efforts, we have dealt with this only. Now because of the pandemic, there is a threat that we'll come back to square one. Okay. So, and because of this the pandemic has made education online. Yesterday, Ashok sir was emphasizing on this. Because of this, the children may drop out. Okay. And National Sample Survey Organization's report again states that mere 24% of Indian households have access to internet. Okay. So also the recent measures of India, government of India, another major important area is that we have seen because of this pandemic, many children are going to get orphaned. Okay. Because they're losing their parents. And now it's very important to address these children in a different way. Okay. BPL, if they belong to poverty households also, and they're orphaned because of the pandemic also, that's going to be a deadly combination. Like we are going to face real challenges there in handling that. Okay. Let us see how best to address that. See, perception of seeing that children as earning hands, why are they seeing it? It's because of their vulnerabilities, because of their needs, because of the compulsions. And also education is the process in India is not yielding immediate incomes. Like if they go to work, they'll earn income immediately. Now, if you want to tell a parent to send their children to school, it's after 10 years of education that you will be earning, right? So it's not pushing. So curriculum has to be designed in a way. Maybe they should be taught vocational training is what we are talking about today. Like they should be taught electricity works, plumbing works, carpentry. If they're taught that, at least they'll be earning at some point. Like not vocational training is 10 plus, 12 plus. We are introducing in certain states. And also what we have to address is the root has to be addressed. We have to extract the problem by its roots. It has the behavior and perceptual change has to be brought, like either by assuring the income to the families or incentivizing them to send their children to school. Okay, indirectly, all the measures the government of India is bringing in to deal with poverty, it will ultimately deal with child labor. So it is a multi-pronged approach that is required to deal with child labor. Okay, some states and countries have performed really well in this regard. Like in India, for example, the states of Tamil Nadu and Madhya Pradesh where trade unions they have recently organized, rural members are implementing this concept of child labor free villages. How are they coming up with what will be happening in these villages? They are initiating dialogue. Okay, they're initiating dialogue with local leaders and employers. So we also have so many ground level staffs, right? We have ground level staff working at village levels. We should use them and tell people ground level staff will be able to better communicate, right? And also collaboration and alliances are also being formed between trade unions and representatives. This is especially in Latin America, okay? And also this is child labor is one area or one space where civil society organizations, NGOs, pressure groups can actually come forward, can actually on war footing deal with this issue, identify the problems, areas where it is worst hit and offer solutions, okay? So it's a chronic illness yet curable. This talks both about pandemic also and also, I mean, this is intended towards child labor. It's definitely a chronic problem, but the hunch lies in finding the right treatment, okay? So challenges that pandemic could cause are certainly significant and manifold, but it is not impossible to be met. What is required is right level of commitment that all the stakeholders involved, right? From parents of the children, the teachers involved, governments, ground level staff who could help children in education. So we already have right mix of policy and programmatic interventions. All we need is commitment and also strategic partnership and collaborations. Just like happened in Latin America, government, employers, trade unions, all of them should come forward and collaborate in dealing with child labor. And also all of them need to pledge under this, they have to pledge that taking action against the child labor, this has to be made a part of United Nations Declaration for 2021. That's what Audra wanted to say. And I've also added some there in bits and pieces. I hope it's clear. Any doubts, please ask.
Okay, ma'am. Let us continue. Let's continue. Gurlin, ma'am, you can continue with the rest of your presentation.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Sir, actually, I need the host status to share the screen.
Vinutna ma'am, can you make her the host? Can you make Gurlin ma'am the host?
Yeah, sure. One second. Ma'am, could you share it now?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, ma'am.
So continuing with the editorials, we were on this editorial again, last editorial for today. So this editorial over here is actually telling about the non-communicable diseases. So currently in the aim of COVID-19 or the pandemic going on, a lot of non-communicable or the different diseases, that is the non-COVID diseases, are actually put at a sideline or they're not actually focused a lot. So this editorial is talking about treating the hidden pandemic. So non-communicable diseases in the COVID times, again related to GS paper 2, issues related to health sector and public policy. So what is currently happening, that is in the second wave time period, the rate of fatality throughout the country, the current rate of fatality is somewhere around 1.16%. And if we focus at a global fatality rate is 2.17%. And about the non-communicable diseases. So over here, a brief introduction of what are the non-communicable diseases. So non-communicable disease is a non-infectious health condition that do not spread from person to person. Again, we know that COVID is a communicable disease because it is spreading from person to person. That is why to maintain a physical distance is also given as a priority. So it lasts for a long time period. That is a non-communicable disease over here. This is also known as a chronic disease. What are the few examples of non-communicable disease? For example, your diabetes and cancers. So a combination of genetic, psychological, lifestyle, and environment factor can cause these diseases. So again, non-communicable diseases are passed on by heredity. Also because of the environmental condition or the lifestyle condition also leads to generation of non-communicable diseases or also known as NCDs. So NCD includes as a heart disease, strokes, cancer, diabetes, chronic lung disease, etc. So all these also amount for somewhere around 70% of the deaths throughout the world. So 70% of the deaths throughout the world are actually happening because of the non-communicable diseases. So we hear key highlights of the non-communicable disease. That is first one over here. We just studied on the first slide. Non-communicable diseases are the world's biggest killer, 70% death worldwide. The main finding is that health service has been partially or completely disrupted right now, because again, the focus is on pandemic, focus is on COVID related problems, and the non-COVID related problems are set at the background. So therefore, not proper facilities are available for the non-COVID related problems. More than half, somewhere around 53% of the countries surveyed have partially or completely disrupted services for hypertension treatments. So what is hypertension? Again, we also call it as a BP problem. That is whether BP is at high or a low level. So somewhere around 49% of the treatment facilities are shut down for diabetes. That means 49% of diabetes treatment has seen a downfall, 53% for the hypertension, 42% for the cancer, and 31% for the cardiovascular emergency. So all these diseases have seen a downfall because of the pandemic situation. Certain rehabilitation centers which are providing the rehabilitation services, all these services are also disrupted. So if we talk about the country level, 63% of the rehabilitation services have seen a downfall. And we also know that rehabilitation services are very compulsory for the recovery of the disease. Because again, what happens is, in hospitals, we go for the treatment or we go for the operations, etc. That means when the disease is at its peak. But when the disease is, like for example, if the medication is done or operation is done, etc., later to that, we follow the rehabilitation or we go to the rehabilitation. For example, if a person who is actually having a problem regarding the heart disease. So that person went to the hospital, got the stent. And later on, again, this hospital, hospital is not going to play a vital role. Whereas nutritionist, physiotherapy, etc., all these also play a huge role in getting that person back on the track. Okay, so again, rehabilitation services, these include in the rehabilitation services. So rehabilitation service also have a huge role in the health sector. 63% of the rehabilitation services are seeing a decline. Screening campaigns, again, a lot of campaigns are done worldwide, also at the national level. So what campaigns, for example, creating awareness among the people, awareness regarding breast cancers, awareness regarding cervical cancers, etc. So all these campaigns, because of the lockdown condition, these campaigns are also seeing a decline, which is also not able to create awareness among people. So early cancer detection is also becoming a huge problem because of this. Obesity is also a huge problem, which is seen especially among the younger generation, because again, the younger generation working from their home, sitting at one place. So obesity is also increasing, leading to changes in the BMI, that is body mass index, which also later on leads to several non-communicable diseases. India's NCD strategy. So India began implementing the multi-sector NCD action plan. That means India's plan is to achieve the 25% reduction in the NCDs by 2025. Also, a scheme that is Atmanirbhar Swasthya Bharat scheme is a major initiative which has been taken by the government. So under this scheme, 64,000 crore rupees will be put down or will be allocated for the rural and urban health and wellness center, along with critical hospitals and laboratories, along with virology sector. That means, again, this money is going to be invested in the health sector development or the infrastructure development. Under Ayushman Bharat also, India has expanded the scope of primary health care to include the screening and diagnosis of NCD diseases. So again, Ayushman Bharat is also under this scheme also, we are helping the citizens regarding the screening or the early detection along with the diagnosis of non-communicable diseases. PM Healthcare Insurance Scheme also covers somewhere around 100 million of people who are considered in the vulnerable category. So, and these vulnerable category people, so whenever they develop an NCD, that is a non-communicable disease, these people go to hospital. And after going to the hospital, these people end up doing the OOP, that is out-of-pocket expenditure, which we have several times discussed that what is out-of-pocket expenditure. So again, PM's healthcare insurance scheme is actually covering these vulnerable people so as to avoid the situation of out-of-pocket expenditures. What is the way forward? That is, in light of COVID-19, NCDs must be understood as the fundamental to health security. Why? Because again, we do not want another pandemic, that is non-COVID pandemic, targeting us. A lesson emerging from the international call was to synergize and strengthening the health sector. So currently, what this point over here is talking about, that we need to focus more on artificial intelligence, more on technology, more on screening, more on diagnosis. We need to increase our health sector infrastructure after taking lessons from the different countries throughout the world. We also need telemedicine centers. So therefore, all these properties together can help us target the NCDs and bring down or reduce the rate of NCDs. The vaccination against COVID, the testing, track and trace strategies. So in the platform through which we are providing vaccination to the COVID people or regarding the COVID, through that platform only. So we do not need to maintain different platforms. Through that platform only, we can also target the NCDs. For example, if a person is going to get vaccinated at the similar center, these person can also get themselves tracked, get themselves diagnosed or tested for several common non-communicable diseases. So again, India will be able to come out of pandemic situation by strengthening the health infrastructure only through the help of Atmanirbhar Swasthya Bharat program or Ayush, etc. All these schemes are going to help us coming out of the pandemic situation. But again, after coming out of the pandemic situation, the overall disease burden the society, that is the NCD disease, the burdens on the society wouldn't be targeted. If that burden is not targeted through these platforms, then that is going to create a pandemic situation. So therefore, a balance should be created in the COVID problems and the non-COVID problems in order to reduce the society's burden regarding all these diseases. So a main question regarding this, that is, what are non-communicable diseases? Why is India in urgent need to recognize NCD in order to avoid a non-COVID pandemic condition? A prelims-based question which can be formed from this editorial, which of the following are covered under the Ministry of Ayush? So first option over here is Ayurveda. Again, Ayurveda is covered under the Ayush and Yoga and Naturopathy is also covered. Siddha is also covered over here. Fourth one is not covered. That is, allopathy is not covered over here. In fact, homeopathy is also covered under Ayush. So therefore, over here, answer is C. That is only 1, 2, and 3. So allopathy is not covered. So this is it. This was all regarding the editorials from my side. Thank you. So whom shall I give the host status to?
Thank you very much, ma'am. Can you forward the host status to me?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So good evening, students. We are back with our additional topics of our discussion today. And with continuation of this yesterday's discussion, like we have discussed about tropical cyclones, but the area with related topic also tropical cyclones, we need to cover the areas related to disaster management. That is why I'm trying to bring out to you, how do you look at this whole aspect of cyclones that have occurred in recent past, how the government has managed this particular event of a disaster. Right, those all things will be coming, maybe they'll be coming in our GS3 paper, or they'll be forming a particular question, like they'll be forming case study in the GS4 paper, like in ethics, and they'll be asking how you will manage that particular kind of a situation if you are made a authority to deal with the ongoing event or the event that is approaching. So that those such kind of questions can be framed, and these the tidbits or the points from the for attempting these particular questions can be brought from the newspaper itself. That is why I'm trying to bring out to you, so that you'll be will be able to track those things from the newspaper itself and learn those things from the newspapers itself. Okay, let me share that that PPT. Okay, the area related to disaster management, that is where we are trying to cover here today. So you can see the flow of our discussion today. We are going to discuss what is a disaster, what is meant by disaster management, and then what are the areas or the components of the or the stages of the disaster management, and how did the government manage the recent cyclone? Okay, and then what are the issues and challenges that the government faced in this particular event, and then the we'll suggest some measures, and also there is a program related to cyclone that the government is handling. Okay, so we'll all discuss all these views. All these areas in this today's discussion. So tell me, what is a disaster? Can we call a natural event like a cyclone or an earthquake, okay, or a volcano, can they be called as a disaster? No, they are actually natural events. We cannot control them. Can human control an occurrence of this disaster, these natural events? Volcano, we cannot control the climate, the cyclones we cannot control, or the earthquake we cannot control. These are natural events, but they will become a disaster. When they will become a disaster? When they affect the life and property of the humans, right? That is existing in these areas. When they affect the life and property of the mankind, then only these events will become a disaster. That is what the disaster means. Okay, these basic things should be very clear from in our mind. Like, it is an event which will create some kind of unfortunate consequences, or it is a sudden or some kind of an event which will obstruct the normal functioning of a community. It will obstruct the flow of economy. It will obstruct the all infrastructure in the area. Okay, and also loss of environment, like destruction of trees, destruction of habitats. So all these events will happen, but you can understand the difference between a natural event which is occurring and the event which why this event will become a disaster. So that is with regard to the slight difference that we need to keep in mind. Okay, and then what do you mean by disaster management then? Okay, what do you mean by disaster management? So disaster management can be said as a management of the resources that are available. Okay, the management of resources that are available in order to lessen the impact of the disaster, right? It can be a multi-layered planning, okay, multi-layered planning as well as implementation that takes place in the area of disaster management, right? It will try to conserve the lives and also the protect the property, both natural property as well as the man-made properties, okay? And then there are two kinds of disaster, which is a natural disaster and then the man-made disaster. We are not going in detail details with regard to disaster, okay? So we'll stick on to our present current contemporary topics. That is with regard to disaster management. And what are the components of a disaster management? See, this is an event of a disaster, and all the components will be circulating around this event. And first, there will be a preparation, okay, or else the mitigation. Well, mitigation is something as an interconnectivity of after disaster, before a disaster, as well as after a disaster. So first thing is preparation. What kind of preparations will be taken before an event occurs, right? And then the response during a disaster, and then the recovery after the disaster, and then what the lessons that we have learned will be taken up in the mitigation, which will be taken forward in the preparation in any disaster event that is be going that will occur in the future. Okay, these are the components. So let us briefly look at it. These things. What is preparedness? These are the steps taken to prepare, reduce the effects of the disaster. And this is where the we should will explain and see how the government has prepared and has taken steps or responded in this particular event of Cyclone Yaas. Okay, and then response. What does this response mean? Responding to the communities which are in distress during an event, like providing them relief measures, okay, relief materials like food, water, medicines, okay, and then temporary accommodation whoever are lying in these coastal areas and all. Right, and then recovery. What is meant by recovery? Recovery means rehabilitation of these people back into their native places, and then recovery of damaged infrastructure. How fastly you are going to recover the infrastructure, like communication infrastructure or the power infrastructure, will get destroyed during a disaster. We should be recovering them, or we should be as soon as possible. We should put them back into the functioning. So that is where the recovery aspect is there, and then the mitigation, the learning that we have done, which will and learning means we will build in some kind of structural measures, we'll take in some kind of non-structural measures, okay, which will be included in this mitigation, so as to ensure that we'll take some kind of proactive way of approaching this disaster, okay, that is with regard to all the components related to the disaster. And next, the cyclone, yes, they must be seeing the whole last week, the whole article, there are many articles which are propped up with related to the cyclone, yes, okay. And then how did the government manage the cyclone Yaas? Okay, the first thing they have done is the warning. They have sent a warning signal to all the low-lying areas. Okay, people who are living in the low-lying areas were given a warning so that they'll be protecting themselves or moving away from those areas so that they'll be less affected by the coming event. And then the safe evacuation of these people from these high-risk areas has been taken. And for this, in support of this, the temporary shelters like from somewhere around more than 4,000 cyclone shelters have been created in the both states of the West Bengal as well as Odisha. Okay, and then it is said that about 15 lakh people, it can be more, 15 lakh people have been evacuated, and it has become a huge challenge. It is one of the biggest challenge the governments have faced during this particular disaster. And also they are focused upon the stocking of relief materials. What are these relief materials? Like food, medicines, water, and the stocking of that thing is very important in order to provide the immediate relief to the people who are suffering from this, who have left out of their native places, right? They are placed in these temporary shelters. We need to give them support through these relief materials. That is why stocking of his relief materials has been focused beforehand itself. And then Navy and Coast Guards have been deployed, and they have performed very beautifully the search and rescue operations. Why? Because some merchant ships might be venturing in the sea, or some fishermen might be venturing in the sea who will be and these people should be rescued as soon as possible. They are venturing into the sea, right? And it is said that at most 250 boats, both who are fishermen as well as the merchant vessels, have been safely brought into our onshore, right? It is a very good thing that they have done. And then the time duration, they have also focused upon the power supply as well as communication networks. That means that they have taken a special care so that any breakout of these networks or power supply will be immediately restored, so that it will be immediately restored. Otherwise it will be a very difficult situation, right? Communication is also very important in order to undertake a disaster undertake the rescue and relief operations during a disaster. In that sense, it is very much important, and that is where they also focus, like how fast we can rectify the infrastructure damage that might come up. And then there is also disaster management response force, and then state disaster response force, right? They have been deployed in order to ensure the human resource management has been also been included in this disaster management, right? they have been very helpful in rescuing and providing the rescue and relief operations to the people during this particular event. Okay, and then let us move on. What are the challenges this government has faced during this disaster? First thing is that shifting this large number of people. I told you there are at more than 15 lakh people have been rescued, and it is a huge task. It is not a simple task that it will be done in a single day. So, and then the following the COVID guidelines, all these 15 people will be placed in the cyclone shelters, and they'll be, what they say, there might not be any kind of physical distance between the people who are placed here. And then following the COVID guidelines during in these COVID cyclone shelters is a difficult task. Okay, every kind of relief material or medical facilities as well as the ambulance facilities have to be placed immediately in nearby areas of the where the cyclone shelters have been erected or they have been placed. And then there is a federal challenge which has been faced during this event. Like the West Bengal government has questioned the center for not providing the proper financial aid. Because the center has provided a better financial aid to Odisha, but however, it is said that we are not supported by the central government. That is one of the federal challenges that we have seen. Anyway, and then we have seen 2 days back, we have seen that one of the faculty members has explained us with the areas of impact on Sundarbans. Okay. Sundarbans are, what are the Sundarbans? These are mangroves. These actually protect us, these coastal areas from the any kind of these events like the storms or the cyclonic events. They'll be protecting them. But however, due to the destruction of Sundarbans, there is a weakness in this region. And then when there is some kind of weakness, these events like cyclones will further disturb the area. And then we have seen that various islands, these mangrove islands, for example, Goramara Island, which is already going under the sea due to the rise of sea level due to the global warming and climate change. It is now again being, it is seen that this island is completely submerged under the water during the cyclonic event. And then many people who are living in these islands, in these Sundarban areas, have to be rescued. And there are many students, many people have fled away from this region, which impacted their life for the past 1 week. Okay, and that is more important. There is even more dangerous thing for the people, right? And then there are certain measures which we can focus upon. There are two ways that we can tackle any disaster or any event of this occurrence, right? There is structural measure and there is non-structural measures. What are the structural measures? Like construction of cyclone resistant buildings, right? And then construction of cyclone shelters as well as embankment of these coastal areas, right? And then bridges and canals, so that there'll be some kind of embankments that are constructed, so that the floods which may occur during a cyclone can be rectified or can be minimized. The effect of the floods can be minimized, right? By building these embankments and all the surface water tanks and all. These are the structural measures that can be taken. And then what are the non-structural measures, like raising awareness, disseminating information as quickly as possible, or else rectifying the communication network system as quickly as possible. These are all things will come into the non-structural measures, right? But keeping in this mind, government has introduced a new program called as National Project or the National Cyclone Risk Mitigation Project. And this project is actually focusing upon undertaking the suitable structural, non-structural measures to mitigate the effect of climate change. And who is implementing this particular program? Or the particular project, it is implemented by National Disaster Management Authority, which is under the aegis of Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay, and then and of course, it is not done. This project will not be done in a single-handed or a top-down approach. It is not followed in this particular area and this particular project. And necessarily, the states have been involved, as well as the technical organization which can provide the technical information about how to manage a disaster or how to manage an event of a disaster is taken from this National Institute of Disaster Management, right? That is the whole area with related to disaster management. Yesterday, I have already discussed the topic about how the cyclones occur and all. If not, you please refer NCERTs again. Okay, read the whole issue of how this a disaster or cyclones, how the cyclones occurs. Okay, there are several types of cyclones, like anticyclone, then there are cyclone, there are temperate cyclones, there are tropical cyclones. Okay, all these information need to be read by you. Okay, that is with regard to this particular disaster. And then we'll move on to certain areas of our discussion today, today's news articles, additional areas, right? There is a report called okay, State of Finance for Nature. It is released by it is a UN report. It is a very significant report. It will give us a value addition in our mains answer writing as well as essay writing. So it is very important for us to note. And then prelims also, they might be asking who has released the State of Finance report, right? Those kind of questions are very quite common in UPSC. That is why it is very important for us to take notes from this particular area. And then it is a UN report. Who has brought it? It is jointly produced by UNEP, United Nations Environment Programme, World Economic Forum, and then Economics of Land Degradation. These three bodies are involved and they produce this report. Okay, what is this report is actually aimed at? It analyzes the investments in what kind in kind of nature based kind of investment, like we are seeing the focusing upon circular economy, like focusing upon making the sustainable development achievable. We need to bring in some kind of nature based solution, nature based capitalism, not industrial capitalism. We need to bring in natural capitalism in our economy. That is where the report is trying to focus upon. So what are the key findings of this report? What is this report is trying to say us? It says that nature-based solutions, the financing of nature-based solution is at very smaller scale. Okay, and then it is heavily relied on public finance. That means mostly the finance is coming from the government itself. That means the private sector is showing little interest in providing this nature-based solution. That is what I'm trying to say. They should move away from industrial capitalism to natural capitalism. Okay, in that sense, the private participation is, it said that the report is saying that private participation is merely around 14%. Okay, and then public funds are in tune of about 86%. And then approximately 133 billion is currently being financed towards nature-based solutions. And it comprises about just 0.1% of total global gross domestic product. See, it is a meager amount that is being invested in this nature-based solution, which is very important in order to address the issues of climate change and global warming. And then what does the report also recommends? It recommends three more points, right? It says that in order to address the climate change and global warming, in order to reduce the impact of all these areas, we need to at least reach the investments of 536 billion by 2050. That is the aim that it is putting forward to all the countries, right? And then aligning the private finance is also very important. Okay, it is as simple as it can be understood very easily, right? It is very much required. And then nature-based solutions should be brought in tune with the current nationally determined contributions, which the Paris Agreement is linked to, right? And I've already discussed with areas related to Paris Agreement in one of our Yojana session. Please revise them. Go back and please revise them. And then let us move on to the next topic here. And 2 days back, I've dealt with the whole aspect of dairy sector, right? Dairy sector, what is the significance of dairy sector and what is the issues the dairy sector is facing? And today there is a PIB news related to this particular thing. Okay, it is also said that today we are actually celebrating World Milk Day. Okay, in that celebration, the Honorable Minister of Fisheries and Animal Husbandry and Dairy, his name is Giriraj Singh. Okay, he has conducted a virtual meeting in order to announce the new awards like Gopal Ratna Award and then eGopala app. Okay, and what is this Gopal Ratna Awards? Okay, it is national awards given for cattle and dairy sector. Okay, it is launched to promote the best performance. Okay. Best practices that are being taken in the dairy sector, and it is going to give awards in three categories, right? best dairy farmer, best artificial intelligence insemination technician. There's no our Ashok sir has told about artificial insemination, right? And then best dairy cooperative or milk producer company or farmer producer organization. And these three areas the award is being focused, right? And then there is a eGopala app. It is an informative app. It provides information regarding managing the livestock, okay, or else the availability or the say, the supply of the livestock, and then information related to access towards artificial intelligence, you know, and all availability of quality breeding services, artificial intelligence, veterinary and first aid. All this information will be provided in that particular app. And why it is said that it is this app is being merged in the human platform. And that is where our connectivity lies. We need to understand what is this Women Platform. Women Platform is actually is a Digital India initiative. It is brought up by Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Okay, it is an umbrella app. Like all the government services, as many government services as possible, the government has included all the services into this Women Gap. Okay, but the welfare services. Okay, for example, they can the number of e-government services like in filing of income tax, okay, and then availing the EPFO organizations services as well as availing other services, pension services, and then accessing of e-land records, crop insurance, all these are being integrated in this like umbrella app, right? And this is where the eGopala app is also being merged into this Umang app. Okay, and then there is one particular news related to health sector. There is a revamped central government health scheme. What is this revamped central government health scheme? It is actually covering three schemes. It is an umbrella scheme covering three schemes. Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi, right? There is one more area where discretionary grant on national health, discretionary grant program is also done. Okay. And then it is, these are all integrated on this IT platform, which is created. It is under the National Health Authority. Okay. What is the objective of this program, this revamped program? It is trying to provide the cashless, paperless and citizen-centric services, right? And what are the points to note for us today from this particular area? There is central government health scheme. It is a scheme for government employees, okay? Like serving employees, the pensioners, the MPs, okay? And ex-MPs are also being covered, and their dependent family members, okay? And then it is actually present in the last 7 years, and it's expanded to 72 cities, right? It is developed by National Informatics Center. Okay, there is an e-referral model that is developed by National Informatics Center, and all the CGHS dispensaries which are present in the all the cities, they'll be connected online so that some kind of smooth way of providing healthcare is being planned from this particular scheme. And there is one more scheme which is under this particular scheme, okay, umbrella scheme, which is Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi. I think I have spoken about this particular scheme when we are covering national policy on rare diseases. Okay, national policy on rare diseases, we have particularly covered this particular scheme. Okay, Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi, this is a financial assistance program being provided to the poor patients who are suffering from life-threatening diseases. And in that thing, national policy on rare diseases is also being supported from this particular fund. Okay, Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi. And then there is one more thing, Health Minister's discretionary grant, right? This is under this, the maximum amount of 1.5 lakhs is being provided to students or the patients whose annual income is less than 1.25 lakhs. Of course, it is actually the program is completely focusing upon the central government employees. Okay. And then whoever the beneficiaries who feel that they are under this category, they can apply for this financial assistance. Okay. And then, through their ration card itself, as simple as that. Okay, there is one more initiative that is in news today, which is SATAT initiative, Sustainable Alternative Towards Affordable Transportation. Okay, in order to ensure that transportation becomes more, transportation uses more clean and green energy, okay, clean and green energy, this program has been initiated by Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. What is the aim of this particular scheme? It is trying to set up some production plants, these compressed biogas plants. Okay, in order to ensure the production, increase the production of these biogas plants, biogas in the economy to at least 15 million metric tons by 2023. Okay, about 5,000 plants are being planned in this particular program initiative. Okay, what is the significance of this initiative to our country? First of all, it has the potential to boost affordable transport fuels and also the clean and green transport fuels. Like we have seen in many cities in Kolkata or Delhi or Hyderabad, we have seen CNG autos, like compressed natural gas autos are running. And then those autos can be supplied with this gas from this particular plants, right? That kind of connectivity can be made. And also we are seeing CNG buses also, like public transport buses are also being created in the in our economy and in our transportation system, right? And then better use of agricultural residue as well as cattle dung. Like we have seen in Punjab and Haryana, the stubble burning is taking place every year. And these stubbles can be collected and they can be brought into these plants in order to generate compressed biogas, right? That means in connectivity with this, what will help? It will also help farmers to earn additional revenue, right? One more connectivity here, right? And then for these plants, the construction of plants, the private sector will be very encouraging, right? It will try, private sector can come up into this area and try to, it is estimated that at most 1.1 lakh crore investments can be coming up into this particular area for this particular scheme. And thereby it will also going to create some kind of direct and indirect jobs. So see the connectivity, the small scheme has the impact in various areas of agriculture, transport and economy, investments, creation of jobs and resolving the problem of unemployment, and also the addressing the issues faced by the farmers of having low income and all these areas it can cover holistically. Okay, these are the areas that I thought of bringing it to you, to your notice. Okay, thank you very much. If you are having any doubts, you can ask us. Okay, that's it for today then. If you are not having any doubts, we can continue tomorrow. We'll meet you tomorrow. Thank you very much.